Thank you very much, Sorin and Mina. And not to lose time, I will start. And my talk is on complex networks, theory and applications. And as you see here, I don't have to define very much the networks because already you had yesterday very nice talks on networks and complex systems in general. And here you can see an example of the web www network, where the nodes are web pages, and the links are the links between the web page and the HTML. And you see the complexity of the structures that we are studying. So if you see it, you can see realize already that it's a complex system. And this work that I'm going to describe why networks are important. And it was done mostly with people from my university, from Scott Kirkpatrick, who is here from the Hebrew University, and with Gene Stanley, who is here also from Boston University. So let me start. I think it's already believed by many people that networks can be a good tool to study complex systems. Many complex systems are usually composed of many interacting entities, and this can be represented by a network. The nodes represent the entities, and the links can represent the interactions. For example, you can think about it as a biological system like a protein network, interaction between protein, social system, it can be interaction between people, so the nodes are the people, and the links are the interaction between them. You can think also, as I will show you in this talk, as a climate network, and the nodes are sites on the globe, and the links are the similarity between the climate in these two places. Or earthquakes also network. Epidemics, of course, flows on networks and propagates on networks. Transport, we have transportation systems like train systems and airline systems, they are all networks, economic networks. You know, we see today that if one company falls, it causes the other to fall. This is relation between the companies, and this relation is something which can be represented by a network. Now, network is not only node and links, but also you can define it more general by giving weight to the link, like cost or strength of the link, or you can give also the node importance and how important it is. And you can represent it also by a weighted network which contains nodes and links which are weighted. This field of complex network is not an old field, it's very relatively young, and it started in 1999, usually. I mean, that's how we see it. And you can see here a comparison that I made in the ISI citation patterns in statistical physics, and we can compare several fields. Fields that started here, like chaos and neural networks, and these are the citations during the year, and you can see that network, which was started by the work of Duncan Watts, that gave here yesterday a nice talk on network. This is the small world. Duncan Watts is here, yes, this is the one. And you see how the citation increases dramatically, and Barabashi, two papers. So I chose the important paper. You can see the change, the big change, like a phase transition in the interest of complex network. And the question is why we are so interested in complex network, why so many people are interested, and I think this is what I want to present in this talk, the importance of network. So one reason is purely related to mathematics, and there is a classical description of network that was in the classical work of Erdos Shreni, which is a very important work that started mainly our understanding of network. And this classical work was taking, let's say, n nodes, and M links and connect the nodes randomly by links. And you get such a structure, which is a network. And one can study analytically some of the properties of this network, like the degree distribution, which means the probability that a node have k links, and is given by a Poissonian exponential distribution. Now, some more results for the classical network is, we call it homogeneous. Homogeneous means that almost every node can see the same number of neighbors. This node, for example, can see two neighbors, it has two links, another one can see three, for example, but typically between two, three, four, but you cannot have many, many links to one node in this simple model, the classical Erdős-Reinl, which was developed in the 1960s by Erdős-Reinl. And this is, actually we now understand that this network is not different from lattices in high dimension. Thanks to Stauffer, I added this high dimension. In high dimension, lattices behave also the same as Erdős-Reinl, the same universality class, the same properties that we see in high dimensions. What is high dimension? It depends on the problem, but high enough dimension, you always see properties like Erdős-Reinl network. You can also calculate in this type of network not only the probability, the degree distribution, but also the critical threshold for the network, how many nodes you have to leave in the network in order that there will still be communication in the network. And this is called PC. This is a critical, it's like a phase transition. Below PC, you have no communication. Above PC, almost all order of n nodes can communicate. And PC is simply 1 over k average. This is for this type of theory. I mean, if you know the average degree, you can calculate what is the critical concentration. What is also interesting for this network, the classical network, is the property of small world, which means that the distance between nodes in this network is proportional to log n, where n is the number of nodes. So you can see even if n increases very much, very large, still log reduces dramatically and makes it small, and this is why we call networks small world. We call our world also small world, and it's related to the sixth degree of separations that we have between people. And these concepts are very important in social sciences. But what was found in 1999, that many real networks are not Poissonian. They do not obey this degree distribution, but they are rather very broad distribution. For example, one kind of broad distribution can be represented by scale-free. Scale-free means that power law distribution, k to the minus lambda. And power law, the k is much slower than exponential. That's why you can have also, in this power law distribution, you can have also high degree nodes. Like here, you have a node which has 10, but you can have also, if the network is very large, you can have 100,000 and many, many links per node. And this was suggested by Barabás and Albert in 1999, where they also presented the model. What is the difference between the two networks? One important difference, instead of homogeneous, here, these networks are homogeneous, which means you see, you have a symmetry that almost all nodes see the same neighborhood. Here, it's not the same. Some nodes see only very few nodes, and some nodes see very many. So these are heterogeneous, and these breaks, in physics we know if you have a breaking in symmetry, translational symmetry, here it's the same, every node, here it's not the same. So translational symmetry breaks, changes the universality class, changes properties, and many, many properties were found to be different for such a complex network, which are not homogeneous. And for example, instead of having a PC to be 1 over k average for this type of network in the range where lambda is between 2 and 3, where lambda is actually between 2 and 3, which for many, many networks, we find that PC approach goes to 0, which means that even if you have you remove almost all nodes in the network, still communication exists, which does not occur here. And this explains many phenomena which were not clear before, and for example, why viruses can stay on the internet for so long time, although people buy antivirus and put it. So it was against the theory, but if you understand that these are different networks, and we know that PC is 0, it means that even almost all the people buy antivirus, still the viruses can spread in the network. Another property which is important for this network, the distance which was here, logen, small world, become even smaller. Another log appears, log-logen. So it means that we shrink the distance by this type of network, scale-free network. And the log-logen was proved analytically in this paper, between lambda is between 2 and 3, and we call it ultra-small world. And this, as I said, breakthrough helps to understand many and solve many important problems. Just to indicate to the contrast between Poisson distribution and scale-free, you can imagine the roads, map roads, the network of roads in the United States, which you have a typical number of roads going out from one node and almost the same number everywhere, and to the airline network, which is very different. Some towns have very many lines and some towns are very low, and indeed it was found by Vespignani and his group that it's a Paolo distribution also with an exponent close to 2 for airline network, which I will discuss later. Now I want to show you some results which are not mine but important in the field and which shows why networks are important in different fields. For example, let me first give an example. Also, the internet was one of the first examples where they found also that the internet network is also Paolo degree, the degree distribution is Paolo, which means you can have also computers which are connected to many, many computers, and this is why we are also interested in scale-free. Now the question is why network study is very important, and I will show you first in biology and medicine. In biology and medicine, in the 1980s, it was found that the gene P53 is very important as a tumor suppressor. A mutation in this gene results in cancer, but still, it did not solve. If we know even the gene, we know the problem, we could not solve the problem, and the reason was given by the three people, Lane, Levine, and Wolgenstein, who discovered the P53, and they say the following. One has to understand the P53 network, which is just like the internet. A small subset of protein is highly connected and controls the activity of large number of other proteins, which means that if we understand the protein itself, we know which protein causes cancer. It's not enough. We need to understand the network. And this is one of the reasons, one of the main reasons, why people were interested to understand better the network of protein, network of or in biology. And like fixing one junction in a road, we know is not enough to fix the traffic in the road. And for example, a paper that appeared in 2005 and immediately another paper, they studied mapping of the human protein interaction network. And this was done in order to understand the interaction of the network, in order to solve the problems, to better understand biology. And one of the results that came out of Uri Alon's work, he found in the network motifs, which are basic interaction patterns, and they occur in biological network, this type of protein-protein network, they occur more often, and the same motifs appear in different type of network, transcription network, from bacteria to mammals. So if you know, for example, in one type, in bacteria, for example, you can learn also about the motifs in mammals and learn more about understanding better biology. So a type of biological network, which is also scale-free, was found by Barabashi also, is metabolic network, protein-protein network, and this is the structure. The structure is very complicated. So we need to understand such complex networks in order to understand better biology. Another example is the human disease network, which was also published by Go and Barabashi and others in 2007. And you can see what they did here, is they took the diseases are the circles, and the links are if the gene, the same gene, influenced both diseases. And you can see by this, you can see, for example, that you can group the diseases, and you can find that all cancer actually grouped in one place, and other type of diseases another. And you can learn more about genes which actually cause diseases, and this, I think, is important for medicine, very important for medicine. So this is in biology and medicine, and let me go to social networks. I don't have to speak much because yesterday we had a very nice talk by Watts, and he gave, Duncan Watts, he gave an example. But for example, what we learned last few years by papers in Nature and the PNAS, by these people, is that if you have community structure, it usually goes like this, that you have small groups, subgroups, where people are connected to each other, very much, and only few connections to other groups. And you can see it, this is a phone, a cell phone network. You can see the groups here, and only rarely coming out here. And this is co-authorships. I mean, people that write paper together, they've also... So this is a complex structure of network, and we have to, in order to understand better the social systems, we have to understand the network structure, and this can help us better find methods. This is a figure, actually, that Dankovat showed yesterday, which is the importance of the network in social. You can see here, for example, the probability to make a friend. If they are friends of your friend, is much higher than if they are not. So the farther you are in the network, the closer you are to the network, the higher probability to be a friendship. And the farther you are, it goes down, and this rule is very important for social understanding of social systems. So these are examples in social network, and let me show you another example of global airline network. Can we learn something from the network? First of all, you can see here, this is a typical network in USA, the network of airline, and this is the degree distribution, which means the number of lines, the number of lines that go from one city. So this is the degree, and P of K, the number of cities that have a degree of 100, for example, and this is normalized, and this is the scale-free degree distribution, and lambda is, you see, around 1.8 here. Can we use this to predict something? And this was shown in a paper, a nice paper by Colizza and Vespignani in PNAS in 2006, and they actually used the network as on the network an epidemic model. And if you use on the network epidemic model and you want to see where the epidemic starts, where the epidemic spreads, and that's what they found. So they took a global network, airline network, and they make the model of epidemics, and they found that they can explain, they can predict, in principle, where the SARS epidemic that started in July 11, 2003, where will it be affected? So, for example, the red, all the red here, is the correct prediction of outbreak, where the outbreak was, and this is done simply using only the airline network, global airline network. Now, correct prediction of outbreak, and also correct prediction of no outbreak. These are the lines, the red lines here. The only places where they did not predict well is the green places here, where they have incorrect prediction. So you can see that actually, one can use maybe this type of network, and maybe to include also other network, other transportation like train and the cars and all these things, in order to better understand the epidemics spreading, and maybe to try to prevent it. If you know the network which causes the problem, you can maybe also use some restrictions on transportation and to make it not that it will not spread and will not spread everywhere. Now, another use of network, another application, is related to transport network. We saw already that transport is on airline network, we have transport. And the question is now, how can we improve transport? How can we make it improve? Do we need to improve transport to improve all the paths, all the links, all the nodes? Or is there a subset of nodes which is very important for the network, which is critical to use, to improve? And what I want to show you here, that there is such a subset. And if you can identify it, which is not difficult, and you improved it, this subset is very small, and this carries most of the transport in the network. So first, let me explain that transport is very much related to a concept which is called minimum spanning tree. Minimum spanning tree, this is a network, let's say here, minimum spanning, and these are the weights. We have a weighted network here, and the weights, 10, let's say 10 hours it goes from here to here, or it costs $10 to come from here to here. And these are the nodes, and this is the network. And now the minimum spanning tree is the tree that connects all the nodes, but with total minimum weight. The total weight is, and this you see in the red one. And this is very easy to implement if you have a network. In order to find the minimum spanning tree, the algorithm is very trivial. You start to remove the highest weight cost of the link, for example here. And from the highest, you go to lower one, lower one, lower one. But it's one condition. If you remove a node, you don't remove this link. I mean, if you remove the link and the network breaks, you don't remove the link, but you continue. In this way, you finally get a tree, which is called the minimum span. So the algorithm is very simple to get minimum span tree. In this case, the red is the minimum span tree. The minimum span tree, as you say, is part of the network, but it's very important for traffic, for transportation, because transportation goes on the minimum, the place where it's minimum cost. And this is very widely used to optimal traffic flow, design, operation of communication network. So what do we know from learning about network on this minimum spanning tree? So first of all, we know before, as I told you, if you don't have weights, the minimum distance, without considering the weight, the minimum distance goes like log log n if it's scale-free. If it's not scale-free, if it's Erdos-Reini, it goes like log n. This is when you don't consider the weight. Now the question, what happens when you consider the weight? So one can solve using methods from statistical physics, actually, and find that when you use the weight and you want to find the optimal way, you can see the optimal way becomes much longer. Instead of going from A to B to go two links here, and it will cost 58, you go from here to here, and it will cost much less. It will cost 29 only. You see the sum of these numbers. And this, the path on the minimum spanning tree, instead of being log log n, they become longer when lambda is between 2 and 3, but still they are relatively short. They are order of log n. However, if you take lambda greater than 3 on Erdos-Reini, and you make the same analysis, the minimum spanning tree, and you find the length of the path that you have to go on the minimum spanning tree, which is important for dynamics, for transportation, this becomes very large, n to the 1/3 instead of log n. So this log n transforms to n to the 1/3, and this log n transforms to log n. This, you see also the useful, the importance, why scale-free are important, because they still become still small world, even if you have disorder and you have weight and you want to find the shortest path, the optimal path, you find this. So this is important, but how to use this? So one can use it in the following way. First of all, let me show you how we take a big network and we see here how the minimum spanning tree looks. This is the minimum spanning tree. And we call this the minimum spanning tree. Minimum spanning tree includes actually reaching everywhere in the network. But if you reach everywhere, you have to, if you want to improve now the network here, we have to improve all the links here. But this is the order of n. Again, very big system. We don't want to spend so much money in improving the system. This is order of n nodes, because minimum spanning tree, as you remember, connects all the nodes. So what we do, we use a concept from percolation, and we instead of looking on the minimum spanning tree, we look on a subset of the minimum spanning tree, which is called the infinite percolation cluster. This is a subset of this cluster. How to get the infinite percolation cluster is also very simple. Now we know that in general for random, at least for random systems, PC is 1 over K0 minus 1, where K0 is the K squared over K. You remember K is the degree, and this is the average of the square of the degree. Now you know what is PC. So what you do, you remove the links. If PC, for example, is 0.8 or 0.5, or 0.4, you remove 60% of the highest weighted links. So you start from the largest weight to the next largest and the next, and you remove until you remove exactly 1 minus PC. And you don't take into account, like in the minimum spanning tree, you don't care if the network breaks. And then you reach exactly percolation, and then you get a system with many subnetworks. But the largest cluster is this, and the largest cluster can be proven to be on the minimum spanning tree, and the largest cluster is not order n, but only order n to the 2/3. For example, if n is 1 million, then in order to fix here, you will need 1 million links to fix or nodes. Here you will need only 10,000, which is 1% only. So this is we call this the super highways. And these are the roads, the extra links are the roads, and this is the superhighways. And we showed in a paper, which was published, I think, in 2006, this is a paper, that actually what happens in a network is very interesting, like we have in real life. When you want to travel from one place to another place, first you travel on small road from A, let's say, to B. You travel first on small roads till you reach the highway. When you reach the highway, this is the largest percolation cluster. You reach the highway, and then you go to this place where you are close to the other to your destination, and you still go again on small roads. So what we have here the largest percolation cluster is dominating in the transport in weighted network. When you have a weighted network, most of the traffic goes on this. So if you now want to improve significantly the traffic in the network or the efficiency of the network, what you have to do, instead of fixing all the network or the minimum span of three, you can fix only zero fraction of the network, and to the two-thirds, the largest cluster here, and this will improve much more dramatically than other methods. For example, if you look on the most high degree nodes to fix, or if you look on the most important centrality nodes, it does not help as much as helping if you improve the largest cluster, because it's a global optimization and you need to make globally, and globally most of the traffic moves on the highways. So what we have in highways is actually very similar to what we have in networks. So now I want to show you one result, another result for how can, I mean, the main purpose of my talk is to show you why networks is important. So I want to show you some examples. I showed you several. I will show you two more. One more example is a model for the internet, which we call Medusa, which is the name, and was suggested, and the topic was suggested by Scott, who is here. And what we find, using also statistical physical approach, which we call K-shell decomposition, which is a very simple method. You remove the lowest degree nodes, and then you remove higher and higher degree nodes, and then you can make the network into about 50 shells, only 46 shells, something like this. And then you get a very simple description of the network, and you can get also very important results. So one result that we see here is that actually the internet, or actually it is the AS level, the autonomous system level, which is about 20,000 nodes, computers. You can divide it into three subgroups. One group is a nucleus, which is the most important networks, which includes only 100 nodes. Now, about 5,000 nodes are connected directly to the nucleus, and the nucleus is connected to other nodes, which we call also the fractal features, but this is the main part of the network. But what is important, that these nodes actually are very important for the network, in the sense that if you remove these nodes, for example, the distance between any pair, or between the averages and with the pairs, almost doubles. So it means that this nucleus is very important for the network, and you can learn many important properties on the network for using this statistical physics approach, which is called K-shell decomposition. And we found also in other networks, in economic network, pharmaceutical network, for example, similar phenomena that can better understand what is the nucleus, what is the core in the economic system, and this is important. So this is another example of networks. And let me show you now a very recent example, which is related to climate, which was just published in two papers, one in Physical Letters and one in Europhysics Letters. So what we look is we do the following. We look on the globe here, and what we know that there is a effect, El Nino effect, which is actually, you can see it here, this is the temperature increases in during the years. This is the years between 1980 and 2005. And you can see the temperature increases dramatically, which is measured in the Pacific Ocean in this range. And when the temperature increases above a certain value, a certain threshold, we call it El Nino effect. So you can see the El Nino comes here, El Nino comes here, there is here three El Nino, another El Nino effect. El Nino is very important for climate. I mean, it's economics also, and we want to know better to understand El Nino. Now, what we do, we separate the globe here into four separate networks. This is one network which includes El Nino regime, another network means the nodes are the positions, and another network in the north and another in the south. And what we did is we take the network, which means the similarity or the cost, the correlation or the synchronization, we did several methods between places in this network. And the same for each one of the networks. And we measure the number of links that exist in the network during the time, all the time, which includes also a linear time. And what we find, that links, actually many links disappear, go down, you see, exactly when a linear appears. This is number one, the regime here, and you see here, when this is the number of links that exist in the network, and suddenly when a linear comes, then there is a big dramatic change in the number of links. Again here, the number of links goes down, the number of links, this is it, one. But what is surprising in this result, that not only the network can identify in the regime where we know that there is El Nino, actually this is the measurement when you measure the average temperature in the whole regime, and then you don't see it so well. Here you see it much better when you measure only locally. But this is measured everywhere. But not only in this regime, we see the El Nino effect, which is known, believed to be also affect other places. We see it also in this regime, and in this, and in this. As you can see in this picture, this is number two. Number two, I think, is this one. Yeah, and number two, you see also the El Nino, and number three and number four. And not only here, where you don't see the temperature at all. You see, this is the average temperature, does not show El Nino. But when you look on the network, you can see the temperature effect, you can see the measuring the temperatures, and making the links between the temperature, you see that the links disappear in different places around the world, which are not in the regime of El Nino, and not... And not only this, this is in height of 5 kilometers. If you go high and you get the results, temperature fluctuations in high, where you don't see almost effect of El Nino, but the effect of El Nino you can see in the network. What does it mean? That there is information which is hidden in the network. The interaction between the nodes maybe is more important than the nodes themselves, which may make sense. So why not to look on the interaction and to see whether we can learn more about El Nino? So, since it is much more sensitive than the temperature, we believe maybe it will be useful in the future, we don't have yet results, to see the phenomena even before the effect. And then if we know it before, this will be a prediction and it will be very important. Not only this, we see also how the link breaks. And what we see here, that they blink actually. This is a typical links, and you can see we have actually three type of links. This is one link that, this is the cross-correlation between the links. And you can see here the link is cross-correlated in the center. Some links are not in the center, they have time delay. This is the time lag, the cross-correlation time lag. So it means they have an effect after 120 days, the maximum is here. And some are very structural cross-correlation which may represent many delays in the weather. And when you look on the links, which we have a definition, you can see that during El Nino there are such patterns, the link appear and disappear, and when you measure these patterns you can see again exactly these are the patterns. We look for patterns of plus, minus, plus, appear, disappear, and you measure only the patterns, you can see also that these patterns appear exactly when El Nino appears. So we not only understand that the link disappear, but we can see that they not completely disappear, but they appear and disappear during the El Nino periods. So I think I used already almost my time. Let me only summarize the conclusion and give some challenges. So, as I said, my talk was on theory and application, so some new theoretical, there are many more, I did not give it, for network and for distances, for example. This was known all the time. L is log n. This is the famous small world result, log n, the 6 degree of separation. But what was not known is that LMST, and this was using percolation, using theory physics, one can find that if you take the MST on a Herdos-Reiny and a random graph, it becomes much longer. It becomes order of n to the 1/3. So this is relatively new result, only three, four years. Although networks were studied, classical network was studied 50 years almost. And another new result is that log log n is the distance when you have scale free. And this log log n becomes log n for scale free when you look on the minimum span tree, which means you look on the optimal, on the on the minimum, on the optimal path. I showed you applications of network studies in understanding better cellular systems, like protein-protein network and metabolic networks and other biological network, gene interaction networks. Social behavior laws, we can find laws in social behavior which could not be found. Laws, you need a lot of statistics, and now as we saw yesterday, you can find laws in social systems. Predicting epidemic spreading using airline network maybe will be a future tool to prevent epidemics maybe. As I showed you, one can improve transport in weighted networks of size N by investing only order of N to the 2/3. If you have a weighted network, you don't need to invest much, you invest only order of N to the 2/3, and you can improve significantly the transport in the network, much better than other classical methods to improve the traffic. I showed you the Medusa model for the internet, that there is a nucleus, a very small nucleus, and this appears in other, not everywhere, but in some complex systems. They appear, nucleus, dendrites, and main component. Changes in climate networks are very sensitive to El Nino. This is what I showed you, that if you look on the network, you can see maybe more information than just by looking on the parameters like temperature or pressure, because maybe the links exist more than the nodes. If you can have two chaotic nodes, but if they are connected together by a link, if you can see the links, the relation between the nodes, you can learn from the link about the important backbone of the climate in the system. Now, what are the open challenges? Open challenges, I see I made a small list here, dynamic networks. We speak about networks which are static usually, but we know that links appear and disappear, nodes appear and disappear, and the weight changes all the time, and this is still missing in the theory. Spatial embedded networks, all the networks that I showed you and many people studied are usually not related to space, but the space is very important, because the space is restriction. We are living on two-dimensional space. So this two-dimensional was not taken properly yet into account. There are some initial preliminary results, but not yet understood. Actually, most networks are directed. Also, the climate network, it's not undirected, it's directed. One place influences the other. Usually it's not vice versa. So one has to take this into account very properly. Optimizing transport, still not finished. There is a lot of questions how to optimize better transport. Now, another point which I want to mention, synthesizing novel materials. This is a very important concept which I think is a challenge for physics in particular, since we know that the network topology is very different from networks of materials that we have today. The materials are simply like Erdos-Reni network, which means each atom is connected to its neighbors only. But now we have tools to make more complex systems in the sense that we can connect not only to nearest neighbors, we have tools, experimental tools, that we can connect, for example, clusters of atoms to other clusters in everywhere, in the system. So we can make materials which actually will be similar topology to complex systems. So we have a huge new field to make new topology of materials and to learn their properties. And there is already some starting points in this field which I think are very important. And as I said, if we can predict extreme events like climate and earthquakes, this will be also very wonderful. Thank you very much for your attention. Yeah. No, you're right. But we can make, for example, connections between clusters, for example, of magnets, which go along the material, even in two dimension. If you go from one place to another, but they don't touch, there is isolation. You can still connect one place here and one place here without interaction with the media inside. It's artificial, but it will have new properties. This can be done now nowadays in the technologies that we have. One can wire any part of the system to other parts with isolation to the other system.
One second, I'll give you a microphone.
Okay, from what I understood, you said that it's easy to construct minimal spanning trees.
Yes.
Because I would have thought that it's a very hard optimization problem.
No, but there are algorithms which are related to physics also and computer scientists, in which the simplest method is very simple. It's almost rigorous, but it gives very good results. It's just to remove, as I said, the links, which highest weight, you go from the highest to lowest in order. But you have one condition. You don't remove if you disconnect the node.
And
if you, and then you go and you get a very good way to determine the minimum spanning tree. These are algorithms, Kruskal algorithms. There are many algorithms. One of them was used by Barabasi already 10 years ago to generate the minimum spanning tree.
Okay, and this gives the minimum, you said?
This case, the minimum, yeah, you get the minimum weight, you get the minimum weight of the system, yeah.
Asking the question?
I just thought I'd make it clear that the greedy heuristic is provably optimal and it's linear time.
Linear time, yeah. And
more or less.
And log n.
And log n maybe, but it's very, very useful.
Okay,
thank you.